Diversity. The wider vision on BCTV is supported in part by the Wells Fargo Foundation.
Good evening. Welcome to Diversity of Wider Vision. I'm Joe Amprey, and we have a fantastic program this evening. Most of you know that February is Black History Month, and this was started by Carter Woodson. They're going to put a picture of him up now. Carter G. Woodson was a prominent Black historian who earned his PhD at Harvard, and he decided that we need to study more about Black history. He called it Negro history at the time, and he picked the second week in February at that time because the birthdays of Frederick Douglass and Abraham Lincoln were in that week. And so for a while, we studied Negro History Week. But it was expanded to the month, and of course, it's celebrated nationally now for this month. Tonight's program will feature living history. Everyone here tonight, and there are five guests, have made history in Berks County, specifically Pennsylvania, specifically Reading. And I want you to know their history because they all have made phenomenal contributions, and they are living history makers. The first person I want you to meet is Carissa Johnson. Carissa, thank you for coming.
Thank you for having me.
She is a district justice, the first African-American female to be elected district justice in Pennsylvania, or I should say in Reading, not Pennsylvania. Next to her is Mildred Gilyard. Thanks for coming.
Thank you for inviting me.
She's the curator of the Central Pennsylvania African-American Museum. She and her husband founded it many years ago. We'll talk about that museum and all the great contributions she and her husband have made in Berks County, and of course, in Reading. Next is Charlie Haynes. Thanks for coming.
Thanks for inviting me.
Charlie Haynes, for 60 years, has been teaching barbers how to cut hair, and he cuts hair. He cuts my hair, he or his son most of the time, and he has a barber school, and Reading has more barber shops than probably any city in the country, but most of the barbers in Reading were trained by Mr. Haynes, and they all go back and talk about him. I'll tell you this, that I go to the barbershop, and we're always talking about all kinds of history, ideas, concepts. I learned so much there. And the person who knows the most is the one who talks the least. We have to pull it out of him. Mr. Haynes is walking the encyclopedia, and we'll try to get him to talk about at least about barbering and Reading. The next person is Leonard Tull. He's my swimming buddy at the YMCA.
Yes.
He is a retired state trooper, the first Pennsylvania state trooper from Reading. Len, thanks for coming.
Thanks for having me.
Last but not least is one of my favorite people, Frank McCracken. Frank, thanks for coming.
Thanks for having me.
Frank's a former city councilman. He is a phenomenal musician, singer, a keyboardist. But Frank's role here tonight is to talk about the board he serves on for the Reading chapter of NAACP. Let's start with Carissa. Carissa, what does a district justice do? What made you decide to be one, by the way?
Well, I decided to be a district judge because I had great mentors, one being Judge Hall, who recently passed away. I actually did my internship with him in college in 2006. I also had another great mentor, a neighbor of mine, Judge Robinson. So I actually had two great individuals that I got to see living the job, and it inspired me to want to give back as well. My educational background and my past work experience, I have a dual degree in criminal justice and psychology from Wharton University and also an MBA from Mount Vernon University. And for the past 10 and a half years, I worked as a treatment counselor at Berks County Jail. And in doing so, I just saw all the disparity and the negativity of the criminal justice system. And I wanted to be able to give back to the city that has given so much to me, Reading, PA, is where I was born and raised. And I just wanted to give back. And I felt like my education and my work experience kind of led me to be perfect for this role.
Well, you ran a stellar campaign, you're well prepared for the job, and you made history. And thank you for coming today and being a role model for many young people, a district justice.
Thank you.
Miss Gilyard, we could do a whole show on her. she runs a phenomenal museum, and we're going to tell some things that she has brought, just to show you a little about the museum. But let me tell you that she is also very active in her church. She does a youth explosion. I'm inspired every year in February, they do a luncheon. Mm-hmm. And they feature people who are making history, people who don't get the credit they'll do. And so I look forward to it every year. I'm inspired by it. I'm looking forward to this year. It's on the 25th
of February. Mm-hmm.
But just tell us how you and your husband got started with this museum and some of the things you've done over the years.
Yes. Okay. Actually, we got started It was founded and established in 1998. However, years before that time, my husband, my late husband, had begun to collect items and he had housed them in our house. And when the group of students got together and we decided that we would just locate the museum at 119 North 10th Street at the old Bethel AME Church, which is a phenomenal place because the building itself was active in the Underground Railroad movement. And the museum focused somewhat on the Underground Railroad and the various means that individuals escaped to freedom. So it tells a part of the unforgotten history that was not taught in the school. And because of that, we have many schools, universities coming through to witness this history that was not actually in the history books per se. And so, but because Frank was so interested in the history of the African Americans in Berks County and the surrounding countries, he just began to tell his story to everybody he came in contact with. And because of that, he just got so much material that we were in everywhere we went, that we were able to just get enough to have a museum established. Now, we don't even have all of the materials on exhibit, so we change it around from time to time because space is limited. Frank was a great motivator to many persons in the community and especially to me, because prior to that time, history was a boring subject to me. But after being with him, I began to research and research. And the more you research, the more you find out, and it becomes, discovering that which was not discovered. And so when he passed suddenly in 2013, we could not let that legacy die. So we continue that legacy today of having the museum at the old Bethel AME Church on 119 North 10th Street. We had been granted a $3 million grant by the governor, but Randall was that time, but it was a matching grant. And certainly in times like this, you would have had to raise $6 million to draw down on $3 million. We thought that was impossible. We tried, though, gave it a good try, but we rescinded that grant. And so we decided we would stay right there at that historical building, right there at 119 North 10th Street.
Well, thank you for, it's inspirational. Schools go there, field trips, we go by. And the fascinating thing is if you go by today and go by a year from now, you might see something different because you have so much material that you rotate things.
Yes.
Now, there's some things you want us to show. First of all, the luncheon will be on the 25th?
On the 24th, February
the 24th.
Yes. And it'll be held at the Doubletree downtown in Ready. And I'm glad to say the seats are sold out for the luncheon, and we're happy. And I'm sure that everyone will be glad that they came to the luncheon.
Okay.
And our honorees, if I might name them at this time, as Kathy Harris and Valerie White, it's Rita Fredericks and Wayne Robinson, Derek Weaver. And we're also honoring, recognizing the students at Penn State because they have been so instrumental in compiling books for the museum and for the community in general. And we do have some of those books on display at the museum. Some of them are free and some of them is a minor donation. But we have this one particular book that Stories Behind and Beyond the CPAM Exhibits, Volume 1 and Volume 2. Volume 1 was done while Frank was living, and they had begun to interview him for Volume 2, but he died in the process. But those students were so into it that they wanted to finish that book, and they did. So they did further research, and they finished it, and then they had Volume Number 2. So I just admire Penn State for those students under the tutelage of Professor Grobman for all that they do for our community and for the museum. I'm also happy to say that on April the 25th, we will be having a trip to the National African American Museum in Washington, D.C., and the Holocaust Museum, because it helps us to grow when we learn of other cultures as well.
So that's something we can still get tickets from. We can contact
Right. The regard. April 25th trip to Washington, D.C. tickets are still available. Yes.
Get them fast because you were already sold out for the banquet. So if you want to get a ticket, you better call you soon.
Yes, yes. And so I'm intrigued also at the many contributions that come to the museum. And one was a letter from the Southern Conference leadership. And I think we had given them a picture of that that was given to the YWCA back in 1933. And so we're going to cherish that, along with a letter that was signed by Carter G. Woodson in his book that he had and was given to Juanita Jackson.
Okay, that's if you want to put that up, you can now. It's actually the biggest certificate we have there.
And yes.
And that's over 80 years ago.
Yes, yes.
It looks like it's done today. It's kept so well.
Yes, they kept them well. Yeah. Yes.
Well, that's history, and there it is. And, of course, that's on display at the museum also.
Yes.
Okay. Well, thanks for bringing it, and you can see it on TV now, but you can see some of these things in person if you go by the museum.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Thanks so much for all you've done.
You're quite welcome.
And that you will continue to be doing.
Oh, yes.
Okay. The next guest is Charlie Haynes, who is a barber and also a teacher of barbers. Tell us about when you started your barber school and some of the people who have become barbers in Reading thanks to your leadership.
Before I start talking about when I got the barbershop, I would like to go back a little farther since this is Black History Week or month. I hope it becomes Black History Year.
Okay.
I worked at 5th and Penn, a place called Ken's Apparel Store. I used to work there making $15 a week.
Wow.
I used to help the ladies go and do the mannequins. I would take all of the mannequins from downstairs, upstairs, help them dress them, all of that type of thing. In those days, we didn't have a FedEx, those trucks, but we had to take boxes of things and ship them off, apparels. So what I used to do is get all of the boxes ready, take them up to the post office by hand, and send them off. And after I stopped working at Ken's, making $15 a week, I decided I needed a little bit more money. So I used to walk from 419 South 7th Street to Berkshire Knitting Mills and clean toilets. I used to bring home $38.16 a week for cleaning toilets. And I received the ribbon as the best toilet cleaner at the Berkshire Knitting Mills. And I was proud of that ribbon.
Mm-hmm.
I used to own a club for teenagers. I had 527 members at 7th and Chestnut Street.
Mm-hmm.
And all the kids from all the communities, whether it be York, Pennsylvania, Allentown, Pottstown, even from Pottsville, they used to come down to my club. I used to charge 25 cents a month dues. And I used to sell a lot of different little things there in the club that I had. So across the street was our barber named Mr. Miller, William V. Miller.
Mm-hmm.
He and his family had come up from Mississippi. And I used to go in there and get my hair cut. And one day I told Mr. Miller, I said, Mr. Miller, I says, you know, my daddy, he also cuts hair. He isn't a licensed barber, but he has those hand clippers. And he cuts hair, and he had shown me how to do quite a bit of that with those hand clippers. So Mr. Miller said that he used to have hand clippers, but he was the first one of us in Mississippi to get the electric clippers. So he was telling me about the Worcester electric clipper, and I told him, I said, you know, if you don't mind, I'd like to come in here and work with you sometime. He says, well, I only have two chairs, and my brother, he does other type of work, electrical work. He's a former policeman, and he does construction work and all of these different things. And I just don't need anybody. So I was persistent, and I just kept going back to him, more or less begging him to give me an opportunity as an apprentice. So finally, in 1956, he decided to allow me to become his apprentice. So I worked on him as a student and an apprentice from 56 to 59. In March 1959, I opened my own barber shop at 227 West Buttonwood Street. And it was one chair shop, and I was figured, you know, I was doing pretty good. I told Mr. Miller, I said, you guys are charging like 75 cents for a haircut. And instead of me charging 75 cents, when I move across town, I'm going to charge a dollar and a quarter because I don't want to compete with any of you guys. I don't want any of you guys' customers from your shop or from up the street at Mr. Mack's shop coming to me. I said I would get my own customers. So in March 1959, I opened up at 227 West Buttonwood Street. And in 1961, there was a young man had a barbershop at Buttonwood Street and I guess at Fairview Street. It was there across from what we call the House of Good Food. He wanted to sell because he wanted to go into partnership with two other barbers. So he convinced me to purchase his place since it was already a barbershop. 1961, I opened that barbershop. I bought it from him and opened that shop up. And that's when I started training young guys to become barbers. I put a four-chair barbershop in there, and I also put a beauty salon in the back. And we was doing tremendous work. I taught my wife how to become do hair, and she also had gone to Empire Beauty School. Empire Beauty School had contacted me. They wanted me to show them how to do our kind of hair because they said they didn't know how to do our kind of hair at that time. So we started showing some of the students from Empire certain things how to do. And eventually I was recognized by some of the other people that's not here in red, and I was put into the Hall of Fame, Barber's Hall of Fame, which most people in Redden don't know about. I have a PhD in barbering, and people doesn't even know something like that exists. And I have trained over 400 people to become licensed barbers in Pennsylvania. There are barbers that I have trained in 9 states, to my knowledge, and 3 foreign countries. When I go to Dominican Republic, I have met barbers that I train over there. At one time, I owned a shop in the country of Dominican Republic, but we closed that shop down. And I can go on and on, but there are other people here that like that need to be talking about what they have done, so I'm going to leave it at that, okay?
But you're going to continue to keep the school on another teacher soon.
Yes, we're in the process of turning this school over to one of my former students. He's a licensed teacher. And since I have been doing this now for 62 years, I think it's time for someone else to start the, take the mail and carry it on.
You're also a notary public and you're also a realtor. So you didn't talk about all the other schools you have.
Well, I had that. Licensed paralegal. I did a few years of law school, and I ran for district justice in 1975. I lost out to Mr. Brian Eisen by 75 votes, since I was a Republican, he was a Democrat. So.
Well, thank you for all you've done for our town in terms of barbers in this city. We have probably more barbers, and most of them talk about being taught by you, and we appreciate all you've done for our community. Leonard Tull is a retired state trooper, the first such African-American trooper from Reading. Tell us about your career and who inspired you, if you would, please.
I was sitting here listening to the other speaker, and I was thinking, how am I going to approach this? I don't know how far I should go back or how I should start, you know, currently or what have you. But to sort of give you a thumbnail sketch of where I began before I became a state trooper, I look at my life as I was a high school dropout. And from a high school dropout to where I am now, I just have to sometimes sit back and say, how did I do that? So, you know, so it's been quite a journey up to this point. As far as my role models, I don't know if there are role models as such, because I didn't look at them at that, like that when I was coming up. I knew a lot of police officers. You know, Bob Berry was one, and Mr. Miller, as you mentioned, Charlie, and others, and Mr. Butler. We used to have good times at the barbershop talking. All these gentlemen were police officers, and it had an impact on me, and not really thinking that I'd go in that direction, but it stayed there. And so years passed, and I met one of the first recent black troopers, which was Benny Brooks, who was stationed here for a number of years, and I looked at him, so I said, this must mean something. You know, I know all these police officers who look like me, and I said, you know, maybe I can try. And this is after, I'm sort of jumping ahead a little bit, because I was impressed before I was even a high school graduate, you know. So that inspired me. I went back to school. I got my high school diploma, and then I got my master's degree eventually down the road after some other things. I became a paralegal, and Charlie was somewhat responsible for that. But I had quite a few side trips along the way until I became what I am today as far as a retired state police officer. And I've been blessed. I worked for the first black commissioner, which was Ronnie Sharp. And during that period of time, when I came on the job in 1968, there were only 7 minorities in the whole state of Pennsylvania. And I used to call ourselves, matter of fact, there was an article in the paper about that. I used to call ourselves the Magnificent Seven. So we were quite a unique group. And in years, subsequent years had gone by, and others have joined the ranks. But I said, I've lived long enough to see, I work for a black commissioner, and currently Tyree Blocker is the current state police commissioner, who is also a minority. So I've seen a lot of changes through my years, you know, on and off the job. So that's, in a nutshell, is my story.
I'll tell you something else about Linda he didn't share with you. I am a sports fanatic. I'm an Eagles fan, even though my son and dad said I should be a Ravens fan from Baltimore, but I adopted Eagles and I came here. They call me a traitor. usually when I talk to Lynn about the Eagles, I didn't really think we could beat the Patriots. I was glad to get there, but Lynn had no doubt in his mind, and so Lynn gave me hope, because he was sure that they were, if they played their game, and they did,
they
would be the Panthers. And he said, he told me what they had to do, and they did it. So thanks for having more faith than I did.
No problem.
Give me some inspiration on our team. One of my favorite people is Frank McCracken, and I always laugh because I think Frank has always wanted to be a musician, but he got talked into being a preacher for a while. He did a good job, but he finally is. He is a phenomenal musician. If you are available on a Wednesday night, go to the Doubletree and Frank will wow you. Or if you go to any funerals or churches, man, he'll wow you also, because he does. He is a phenomenal musician. Okay. Unfortunately, he's not playing music tonight. I've had him come on. He even came on and wrote a song for his mom once and came on and played it for me on the air.
Okay.
But tonight he's going to talk about NAACP, where he is a board member, about the Reading chapter. So Frank, I'd rather hear you talk about music, but this is Black History Month, so please tell us about NAACP.
Sure, the NAACP, National Association for the Advancement of Colored People, and it's got a ripe and rich history, going back to the, I guess, back in the 1920s, and with the Niagara Movement involving Booker T. Washington, W.E.B. Du Bois, and a number of others who came together for the purpose and of advancing the cause of African Americans, who were colored people at that time. Went from colored people to Negroes to
black
to African American to people of color, and but we've always been who we are. We are a very close-knit people and family. We have our history and our beginnings really has a lot to do with our faith and belief in God. And the NAACP had a long history and involvement with the church. We know that Dr. Martin Luther King, who was a Baptist preacher, and he also was part of that movement. And as a matter of fact, in speaking about Dr. King, his last sermon, the sermon that he preached, I Have a Dream, he preached that, or he gave that speech in the Mason Temple in Memphis, Tennessee, which is a Church of God in Christ, which is a national headquarters. And he spoke about a dream. And I think many of us, most of us, have that book, going back to the beginnings of with Washington, Booker T, and with Du Bois. They had dreams. They had goals that they wanted. W.E.B. Du Bois coming from Barrington, Massachusetts, and not really exposed to racism. When he came into the South and experienced it, it was a shock. It was a shock to him. And he was one who advocated for the talented 10th, that there are 10% of our population are genius and brilliant. And he wanted to advance that cause, where Booker T. Washington founded, was there a Tuskegee Institute, and he really pushed young people into the trades. But both of them, even though they seemed to be at odds, were on the same page. And the fact that a mind is a terrible thing to waste, and a mind is a tremendous thing to develop. If you develop the mind, it will not be satisfied with just being mediocre. And it will not be satisfied with just being, passe. The mind will continue and will hunger and thirst. As you've heard, those of my brothers and sisters here speaking about their beginnings. We all have a beginning like that. We had people that influenced us. Pat T. Miller. Those of us that are from this city, we remember Pat T. Miller. We remember Reba Templeton. And we remember my father, James McCracken, and others. We remember Dr. Goodwin and Dr. Smith, Dr. Terry, Dr. Page. And these are people that we saw as young people who really were professionals, and that certainly inspired me. It wasn't so much the NAACP as it was the people who were part of that organization. They are the ones who really inspired me, and I would suspect others of us, to want to be something. That the NAACP is a vehicle, it's a medium whereby we can channel our energies in an organized fashion, in an organized manner. They have the Freedom Fund banquet every year, which is par excellent. We honor people, we provide scholarships for young people, we have a political action committee that gets involved in all kinds of activities. We have a committee where people come in and make their complaints, like the Human Relations Council. If I could really kind of just say the whole egg in the nutshell, the NAACP really is a family. It's a group of people, it's a community that involves itself in development, in developing, providing example, building character. And because of that, I'm involved. And we have a wonderful president in Stacey Taylor, and a number of other members on the executive committee, and I'm just excited about what they've been able to accomplish in this past year with community town meetings involving the police departments and involving elected officials and community members and actively advocating for a positive and meaningful change. So if anything, I would say the NAACP is open. If you're interested in becoming a member, we meet at Zion Baptist Church the second Mondays, first and second Mondays of the month, and certainly welcome to come and participate. And We'd love to have, and we're not, and it's not just a black organization. The NAACP is open to anyone in the community. And it was founded by, it was a diverse group of people that founded the NAACP. It's great, great history. And I'm proud to be a member.
Well, thanks for what you do, and thanks for coming. If you have questions, we're live on Monday, the 12th of February, and we'll be here until about 8:55. You want to call in, you can ask questions. The number is 610-378-0426. We'd be glad to entertain any questions you have about participating with the NAACP, or if anything you want to go over and see the museum, or any questions at all for any of us. I am fascinated. Most people know that the NAACP was part of something called the Niagara Movement, and they actually met in Canada. Du Bois was the only actual black founder at the time, so there have been whites always involved. Many of them Jewish, so we've always been multiracial, multi-ethnic, and even today, people who are other groups can get involved if they need help with the NAACP. The Reading Chapter has been around since about 1920, and so it has a long history. And of course, Ms. Stacy Taylor is the current president. They've been very active recently in the gerrymandering effort, so we're making progress there. We have a caller. Good evening, you're on the air. I'm glad to hear that you called. Do you have a question or a comment?
Yes, I do. I have a question for Mr. Tull. I believe I have your program and was listening, and I believe he said, was he the first African-American state policeman in Berks County?
Yes, that's correct.
Because I didn't hear other names. I thought the first state policeman was Eugene Thompson.
Mr. Thompson was, Eugene was not a good friend of mine who has passed away. He was a driver's license examiner hired by the state. They wore uniforms at the time, but he was not a police officer.
Oh, okay. Because my friend I went to school with, her sister, married him, and they had beautiful children, all
yes.
scholars. And I didn't know that. I thought he was, I thought the first person in that office. No, in that building?
Yeah, Eugene was a very good friend of mine and an excellent driver's license examiner who did that for years. Matter of fact, people would come to the barracks to request him to give them their driver's license. So he was well respected.
Well, I'll tell you, he was, because a friend of ours wanted to get his license, and I said, you know, he requested him,
mm-hmm.
and he was you just felt very comfortable around him. I remember that, mm-hmm. and I knew his family, and very well respected.
Yeah, and
he's
sorely missed, even today.
Yes.
Oh, yeah. I do enjoy your program. I watch, and I love anything about Berks County, and your program brings it. So I thank you for that.
Thanks for watching. Thanks for calling. Uh-huh. If you have any suggestions,
you're welcome.
If you have any suggestions, you'll see a visual in a few minutes where you can call or email us. You know, it's funny. Things are changing because when I was 16, everybody wanted to get their license.
Yes.
That was. And I'm amazed at the number of young people today who don't want to drive as rapid as we did.
And
perhaps someone who makes you feel comfortable because you're all nervous. You know, I'll never forget. I got my license in Maryland, and I made a mistake on the written part. I should have failed the written part, but this lady felt sorry for me. She knew my dad and felt sorry for me. And I got my license. So I'm driving around now, and I'm fake. If you want. I'll never forget that. I was so nervous, and the questions were easy, but I was just frightened. And she happened to have worked with my dad and felt sorry for me. So I drive because somebody felt sorry for me, and I'm glad somebody was gentle. I oftentimes have my grandkids in the car, and today we have these GPS, so we can find anything. And I have the worst sense of direction in the world. I can find anything, and I always say to one of my grandkids, if this GPS wasn't working, would you know how to get home? And they usually tell me they know. But it's nice to know that Mr. Thompson was. Make people feel that comfortable.
Yes, he did. Like I said, because I worked with Gene for several years while I was stationed here in Reading, and people come to the front desk when I was working at the desk, and you know, is Mr. Thompson working today? Uh-huh. And I said, well, you have to go around the corner. He's over there. Yeah. So, yes.
And, you know, and one of the challenges, I'm sure you've all faced this, when you're only a minority, everybody remembers you.
Right.
Yes. And it's always tough when people come in who remember you in some form or fashion, and you don't remember them. I was in church yesterday, and a lady came up to me and talked about my having spoken to her class. And I couldn't remember. She said, now, you know, my son is now the principal of Reading High School. And then I went on to talk about what a great job he was doing, but how his mother, who's retired now, she was in church yesterday, but you've all, for the most part, been the first. You were the first one in the barber's places, and then I'm sure because you were one of the few first backstage troopers, these kind of things happen.
Well, you're exactly right, because one thing about being a state police officer, or a police officer in general for that matter, is that when someone comes up to you and says, oh, I remember you, and you're thinking, was someone I arrested? you sort of take a right. step backwards, but no, they'll come up and say, oh, you know, you helped me out on the road or whatever, and I go, yeah. So that does happen.
Yeah. Most of the people I know in law enforcement don't list their numbers, because there may be somebody who was arrested, and of course, even though they were arrested and should have been arrested, they carry grudges, and so, but you guys play a very important role. Yes. Without you, would not have order, and would not have, you know, we say peace. It's fascinating, though, in this town, because it's a small town.
Yes.
And they always say, be careful what you say about folks, because you might run into his cousin or his brother.
That's true.
You mentioned Thompson. Thompson was one of the first presidents, early presidents of NAACP, and later on his son came along, Billy Thompson came on to be the president. He was also an early banker.
Ira Thompson.
Ira Thompson. Yes.
And so there's so much history around. And then I think about the Miller brothers in terms of realty. There was Lewis Miller and
Roosevelt
was a pilot.
Yes, yes.
And actually a Tuskegee Airman.
Tuskegee Airman, yes.
And so that family is phenomenal terms of.
Speaking of Mr. Thompson, who was the examiner, he's the one that examined me when I got my license. I was happy.
Same here.
Yeah. Well, Ms. Gilyard, your church has played a major role in this town. You know, when you think about the Underground Railroad, and I think some people don't understand how that Underground Railroad worked. We think of railroad tracks, and we think of railroad with choo-choo and engine, but actually it was a series of stops and highways.
Absolutely, and it's amazing how many people will say to, are we going underground and all like that, and no. And we had to explain to them that it used our railroad terms only to show you how the people got from one place to the other. Okay, so and they are amazed, and we've had to have that kind of thing here in the north. I said yes, it existed in the north, and you had slaveholders right here in Berks County, Heister's Lane. Mr. Heister was, you know, and the slaves were considered property of their slave owners, and they were registered at the county courthouse. And we were fortunate enough to get a deed that, you know, said this African or this Negro belonged to so-and-so, and it had the last name of that person. It was like a piece of property.
Chateau.
Yes.
It was interesting that you raised that, because when we talk about the Underground Railroad, Reading, Berks County, Pennsylvania was very active. And people came up from the South through Lancaster. The Quakers were very, very much the friends. Were very, very involved in the Underground Railroad. And then we go to the Kirbyville Inn, and you go to the Pine Forge, and you go to, you know, you go up to Pottsville. People traveled, but in this particular area, there were a lot. Washington Presbyterian, Bethel AME, the AME Church. And talking about in Robazonia was an area where they had slaves, but our history is very interesting in the fact that there were some free people here in Berks County that were, and you mentioned the court court records that documented that. So rich history in Berks County, and we participated as a community. There was a German stock and they some of them gave their slaves their freedom, yes. Which I thought was very, very interesting. They also took their slaves to church with them. They were not afraid to allow slaves to learn to read and write and True. To learn their trades. True. So Berks County, I won't go as far as to say the slaves were happy, as the people would say, oh, they were happy people. And we know that's not true. You know, nobody liked to work for free. You know, but they were not, as they were better taken care of, I should say that. They were better cared for in many cases than a lot of other places. And we were very progressive in the terms of our approach to slavery in this area.
The AME has a church has a very rich history. Yes. Most people know that Richard Allen and Ephron Smith were actually praying in Philadelphia at a white Methodist church.
St. George, yes.
And they were kicked out.
Pulled up off their knees while they were praying, and they simply said to them, please let us just finish our prayer and we will trouble you no more. And that became a true statement, because after that incident, when they were interrupted Absolutely. While they were praying, they had made up their mind that they were going to start their own congregations. And it was at that point that they ventured out, and from a blacksmith shop, they went on and got the Free African Society, and then went on further than that, and then they became the African Methodist Episcopal Church.
And mm-hmm. the rest is history.
And the rest is history.
Absolutely.
Now we're history. Worldwide.
Mm-hmm. One of my favorite stories is a guy named William Box Harris, yes. who was a slave in Virginia, who had himself put into a box,
mm-hmm.
and the box was mailed to Philadelphia.
Yes.
And he stayed alive in that box, so the box posters got the box of Philadelphia, and then he got out, he was a free man.
Yes.
The other thing that's frightening, though, is that there's a movie I haven't seen, I need to see, it was called 13 Years a Slave.
Oh, mm. yeah.
And there were cases also where people who were actually free people in mm-hmm, the North mm-hmm. who were captured.
I have a story, my great-grandfather, Marcus McCracken, born in 1820 in Virginia, and he said that he was not born a slave. He was sold down the river. He was made a slave.
Oh.
He was made a slave with his brother Booker and his sister Julia. He was born in 1814, and Booker in 1825. They were taken to Newberry, South Carolina, mates, and they were made slaves. They were enslaved, and that just kind of really resonates with me from the standpoint that everybody wasn't, and a lot of people think that. And that people just, everybody, all black people were slaves, but that's not the case.
Right.
Up until a period of time, they were indentured servants. Some of them, some came free, and some came from Haiti, from the revolution, and came into Charleston, and were never slaves. So it's a history. And then there were Indians who were black, believe it or not. Mm-hmm. There were mm-hmm. black Indians mm-hmm. who were here before Columbus came.
Yeah.
And before the Mayflower.
Yeah, that's right. Before the Mayflower. Yeah. And they came before Columbus. And their descendants are still here today.
Mm-hmm.
So mm-hmm. we really are a diverse people yeah. With a rich history. And our history doesn't begin yes. in slavery. It predates slavery.
Most people know that when Columbus sailed west, he was trying to find a route to Asia. And he thought he saw Indians. He yes. thought he was in India. And to this day, we refer to Native Americans as Indians, but that was a misnomer.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
They are the real first Americans. The other fascinating thing, and I have enjoyed, my daughter-in-law is Haitian. Though she's lived her whole life here, her parents came here from Haiti. And so two of my grandchildren have Haitian or French names.
Mm-hmm.
And it's interesting because the Dominican Republic and Haiti share the same island. But Haitians call themselves black. Most Dominicans will not call themselves black. So the same island, and they both have a history of Europeans who came, some from France, some from Spain, and bought slaves and founded these islands. But it's interesting how our history has evolved.
My grandmother's maiden name was Bonaparte. I had an uncle Napoleon.
Okay.
Napoleon Bonaparte. But Bonaparte was not French. He was the emperor of France, but uh-huh. he was born in Corsica. His uh-huh. family came. So it was Bonaparte.
Uh-huh.
They came through Haiti, and so the Bonapartes, some of our family came through that route, through Haiti, and came into Charleston in 1860. There were Bonapartes who were already 100 years old. And again, and some of them didn't come as slaves. They came as free people to the Americas. So, and I found Bonaparte's in Africa, which is, I told you about that. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Really,
you know what's ironic? I taught a little bit, I had a stint in education. And what you were saying about history, mm-hmm. I was never a history buff. Mm-hmm. But the things that we just discussed here tonight, wouldn't it be great to have that in a book that in our schools, that the rich history of our people and that are contributing and still contributing
still
and have contributed.
Yes.
And but you have to wait till a month in February to find out this information.
That's correct.
Which is really unfair.
No, we have to do something about that. Yeah. We'll have to address that.
You can't relegate our history to a month.
No.
It predates it predates that. And the fact that Haile Selassie can, his he can trace his roots, mm-hmm. Back, back. And they documented that. So it's not information that's lost. It's just information that is not taught.
Yes.
Yes.
It's not taught. We
that's
have a
it.
Rich, again, I said, we have a rich history in Reading Berks County.
True.
With with Birdsboro down by the and Robinsonia.
Yeah.
I found a Gibson family, for example. They were in Robinsonia, and there are pictures of them in school back in the 1900s,
Uh-huh. There you go.
Yeah.
Yes. Most African Americans are multiracial. Most African Americans have Indian and white blood. We just don't trace them. We have this, what we call a one-drop rule.
Yeah.
So what has happened is that if an African American had any black blood, he was African American.
True.
And so that has happened.
Still today.
The most famous story
today.
Is Sally Hemings.
Yes.
And Jefferson had both black and white families, and they were kept separate. And there's a famous novel about one of his daughters married into the white community and lived as white. And then one day, when she was about 80 years old, she fell off a horse. And the granddaughter picked her up and said, "I want you to know that Grandma really is black." And the kids said, "Grandma has lost her mind, there's all kinds of stories about our history. A very famous novel is the autobiography of the Next Color Man by James Weldon Johnson, about a guy who was passing, which has happened. We only have a few minutes left, so if you have any questions, you better call fast. But I want to remind you that we like for our audiences to give suggestions. Don't forget to call me or email me, and it'll come up in a few minutes. Next month will be Women's History Month, and I'll have a lot of ladies on talking about the contributions that have been made by women. And I want you to be aware that there was a lady named Alice Walker who wrote a book called The Color Purple, who called herself a womanist because she says, I'm both a woman and I'm black. And so therefore she gets a double whammy. She gets sexism and racism that she's been victimized by. But I think the important thing is that we need to love all people. And the great thing about King and about Obama is that they always forgave. No matter what you call Obama, he always kept his composure. He said that we have to, the way to turn the enemies into friends, to take that is with love. And so we can't be bitter. We have to be positive because often many people who were once time racist have become best of friends and supporters. And all of our success, the NAACP has been multiracial. There have been whites who cooperated, there are members who support us, and we appreciate that. And the same thing is true about this program and about even the museum, the people who are contributing, have worked with Frank and Mildred in terms. It's always been wonderful. And we always have heroes and role models. And I was doing my doctorate in race relations with all the white professors who wanted me to study about blacks. So that's been an inspiration for us. I want to thank all of our guests. I want to call them out again. Carissa Johnson, one of the first African-American district justices. Mildred Gilyard, the curator of the CFRAM, the Central Pennsylvania African-American Museum. Mr. Barber trainer, Mr. Charlie Haynes, who trained most of the barbers in Reading. The first African-American state trooper from Pennsylvania, or not from Reading, but from Reading, Leonard Tull. And Frank McCracken, a wonderful musician and board member of the NAACP. Thank you all for coming tonight. Thank you for what you do for our community. For viewers, please call me. The number will come up in a few minutes, 610-372-5049, or fax me at 610-372-2448. You can reach me at Joseph Amprey, joseph.amprey @lab.cushing.edu if you want to make suggestions about future programs. We're out of time. Mm-hmm. Thanks, everybody, for viewing. Tune in again on the second Monday in March. We'll see you again. God bless. Good night. Take care.
Diversity, the wider vision on BCTV is supported in part by the Wells Fargo Foundation.